Thoracic aortic aneurysm. Aortic aneurysm is defined as diffuse or localized full thickness dilation of aorta with diameter of 50% or greater than normal aortic diameter. Thoracic aorta with diameter greater than 3.5 centimeters are generally considered dilated and greater than 4.5 centimeters aneurysmal. Incidence of thoracic aorta aneurysm is 6 to 10 cases per 100,000 patient years. Median age of diagnosis is 65 years for men and 77 years for women. Aneurysm occur 2 times more frequently in males. They classified according to the segment involved, size, shape, and etiology. Recent population-based studies suggest an increasing incidence of thoracic aortic aneurysm. Asymptomatic patient with thoracic aortic aneurysm initially managed medically. Surgery indicated for symptomatic patient, patient with rapid aneurysm expansion, and with diameter of aneurysm greater than 5 centimeters dependent on body size. Risk factors for development of thoracic aneurysm are hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, smoking, genetic connective tissue disorder as Marfan, Ehlers-Danlos syndromes and others, family history of aortic disease, presence of bicuspid or unicuspid aortic valve. Aneurysms are more common in persons with COPD than in those without the lung disease. Aortic disease proximal to ligamentum arteriosum associated with degenerative tissue disease in a vascular wall. Distal to ligamentum disease strongly associated with atherosclerosis. Let's look into structure of aortic wall. It's comprised of several layers. Endothelium has direct contact with blood, it's easy to traumatize, and it's a major site for atherosclerosis. Media comprise 80% of aortic wall thickness, has multiple structural proteins, including collagen and elastin. Adventitia composed mainly of collagen and houses the vasa vasorum. The elastin content of ascending aorta is high and diminishes progressively to the descending thoracic and abdominal aorta. Increase in activity and amount of specific enzymes as elastase, collagenase leads to the degradation of structural proteins. The combination of protein degradation and mechanical factors causes cystic medial necrosis with cystic space in the media filled with mucoid material. Elastic fiber fragmentation and loss with degeneration of aortic media results in weakening of aortic wall, loss of elasticity, and subsequent dilation. Classification according to the segment and wall. 60% of aneurysm in wall of ascending aorta. 10% of thoracic aneurysm in wall, the arch of aorta. 40% involve descending aorta and 10% thoracoabdominal aorta. Location, site, and symptoms vary according to etiology of aneurysm, as well as pathophysiology. Genetic connective tissue disorder expand in aortic root, ascending aorta, and aortic arch. And pathophysiologically, they have defective fibrillin, collagen, and secondary cystic medial degeneration. Cystic medial degeneration pathophysiologically expressed as de novo cystic medial degeneration in aortic wall, usually located in ascending aorta and aortic arch. Atherosclerosis usually present in descending aorta, atherosclerotic plaques weaken of the vessel wall. Inflammatory disease like rheumatoid arthritis, Takayasu syndrome, giant cell arteritis, has variable location. And we can see granulomatosis inflammatory reaction in adventitia. Infection disease has variable location as well, and it can be septic emboli and direct bacterial inoculation to the aortic wall. Traumatic disease, which damage vessel wall and presents with intramural hematoma located in aortic isthmus and proximal descending aorta. Clinical presentation is vary according to the segment of aorta involved. With aneurysm and ascending aorta, we can see new aortic valve insufficiency, left ventricular dilation, and congestive heart failure. Myocardial ischemia due to compression of coronary arteries, right ventricular inflow-outflow obstruction, and superior vena cava obstruction manifested as distended vein in the neck. Rupture to the pericardial space can cause tamponade. Overall ascending aneurysm tend to cause anterior chest pain. Aortic arch aneurysm may involve the great vessels. They can cause hoarseness, which results from stretching of the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and they usually present with pain radiated to the neck. Descending aortic aneurysm have variable clinical presentation. They may compress the trachea or bronchus and cause stridor, wheezing, or cough. Compression of esophagus results in dysphagia, erosion into surrounding structure results in hemoptysis, hematemesis, or gastrointestinal bleeding. Erosion into the spine may cause back pain or back instability. Spinal cord compression or thrombosis of spinal artery may result in neurological symptoms or paraparesis or paraplegia. The aneurysm may thrombose or embolize clot of arteriomatous debris distally to abdominal, renal, or lower extremities vessel with corresponding ischemia of those organs. May rupture to the left pleural space. Overall distended aneurysm tend to cause pain radiated to the back. Indication for surgical repair of thoracic aortic aneurysm. Atherosclerotic aneurysm with diameter 5.5 centimeters in ascending aorta and greater than 5.5, and descending aorta 6.5 and greater diameter, usually considered to be surgically repaired. Patient with familial thoracic aneurysm have diameter more than 5 centimeters in ascending aorta and more than 6 centimeters, which considered for elective surgical repair. Severe aortic regurgitation, aorta annual ectasia with dilated aortic root, congenital bicuspid aortic valve with aorta more than 4.5 centimeters, this all factor for consideration for surgical repair. Contained or impeding rupture, rapid expansion of aneurysm or growth rate of 1 centimeter a year or faster is indication for elective surgical procedure. Symptomatic patient with refractory pain in any size of aneurysm should be considered for surgical evaluation. Thoracic aorta dissection. Aortic dissection is defined as separation of the layers within the aortic wall. Tear in the intimal layer results in the propagation of the dissection secondary to blood entering the intima media space. Incidence of thoracic aorta dissection is 3 to 4 cases per 100,000 patients per year. Dissection is associated with high mortality rates. The most common site of dissection is the beginning of the ascending aorta, with 90% taken place within 10 centimeters from aortic valve. Classification of thoracic aortic dissections. There are two major groups of classification of aortic dissection. First, it's DeBakey classification with three types. Type 1 involves ascending aorta, arch, and descending aorta, and comprised of 10% from all dissection. Type 2 involves ascending aorta and aortic arch, and this is 60% of aortic dissection. Type 3 involves only descending aorta, and this is going to be 30% of all aortic dissection. Another major group is Stanford classification with two types, type A and type B. Type A involves ascending aorta and arch, or this is DeBakey type 1 and 2. And type B aortic dissection involves only descending aorta. It's the same as DeBakey 3. Risk factors for the aortic dissection are similar to those for development of aortic aneurysm, with hypertension being the leading factor. Additional important risk factors are pregnancy, cocaine abuse, chest trauma with decelerated mechanism of injury, and iatrogenic causes or injury from cardiac procedures. Patients with acute aortic dissection typically present with sudden onset of severe chest pain, and location of this pain frequently indicates the part of aorta involved. For example, anterior chest pain and chest pain then mimics acute myocardial infarction, usually associated with anterior arch or aortic root dissection. Aortic dissection acute type A and type B dissection with associated rupture, leak, or distal ischemia is indication for emergent surgical intervention. Let's talk a little bit about diagnostic test. Chest X-ray. On chest X-ray present of aortic thoracic aneurysm has widening mediastinum, unusual aortic contours, and displacement of the trachea or bronchi with large aneurysm. Lateral films demonstrate loss of retrosternal airspace. Aortic calcification may outline the border of the aneurysm. CT scan. This is frequently test of choice. Accurately shows the size of aneurysm, assess dissection, mural thrombus, intramural hematoma, free rupture, and contain rupture with hematoma. Procedure is non-invasive, but this procedure requires nephrotoxic contrast and radiation exposure. It's very useful for serial examination for aneurysm expansion. Another very useful technique is transesophageal and transthoracic echocardiography. Transthoracic echocardiography can show aortic valve and proximal aortic roots. It helps to detect aortic insufficiency and aneurysm of sinus of Valsalva. However, transesophageal TE much better demonstrate aortic ascending thoracic aorta and descending thoracic aorta. Even there is a limited areas for transesophageal echocardiography of the distal ascending aorta, transverse aortic arch, and upper abdominal aorta. TE has superior capabilities to reveal aortic dissection. MRI allows evaluation of entire aorta, branch vessel, aortic valve, pericardium. It accurately demonstrates location and extent and size of aneurysm and relationship to branch vessel and surrounded organs. It avoids nephrotoxic contrast. However, This technique has limitations as length of the study and lack of available scanners for emergency evaluation. Aortography. Aortography allows evaluation of entire aorta branch vessel takeoff of coronary ostia. It helps evaluate coronary anatomy, ventricular function, aortic insufficiency. However, it cannot define the size of aneurysm. It implicates usage of nephrotoxic contrast, radiation exposure, and length of procedure. It can cause embolization from laminated thrombus and stroke. Now, before we are going to talk about surgical repair, I want you to see several echo clips. First clip, it's thoracic ascending aortic aneurysm. On the second clip, you can see compression of right atrium with big ascending aortic aneurysm. On a third clip, you can see dissection of ascending aorta. Dissection starts right away after sinotubular junction in aorta. Next clip represents dissection in aortic arch. You can see true lumen and a false lumen of dissection. Usually, true lumen is a little bit smaller than false lumen. False lumen, it's dark, there is no flow, and it's bigger size. There is another clip when you can see dissection flap in the arch. Surgical technique. Surgical technique is vary according to the aortic segment and valve. First, we'll a little bit talk about ascending aorta. There are several ways to repair or replace thoracic aortic aneurysm in ascending position. On a picture A, ascending aorta replacement with graft connected above the sinotubular junction and extended to hemiarch distally. On the picture B, it's aortic valve replacement and graft to ascending aorta. Picture C, composite root and ascending aorta graft replacement with mechanical valve prosthesis with reimplantation of coronary arteries into the graft. And on a picture D, this is valve sparing DEVIT reimplantation procedure. Anesthetic management is going to vary according to the surgical intervention and extent of aortic graft. Next, depicted surgical technique for aortic arch. And you can see that on the first figure, aortic aneurysm is open its entire length and extended through the aortic arch. Second, shows prosthetic graft implanted with distal and extend to descending aorta. And last picture shows the graft is pulled back into aortic arch for implantation of arch branch vessel and construction of the proximal anastomosis of aorta. Management for ascending aorta and arch aneurysm. Surgical approach for ascending an arch aneurysm, it's usual median sternotomy. For cardiopulmonary bypass, both procedures for ascending aorta and arch aneurysm usually done under cardiopulmonary bypass. For ascending aorta, aortic cannula for bypass placed distally to the lesion, or if it's impossible to do, to the peripheral vessel, femoral or axillary artery. Aortic cannulation for arch procedure usually done to peripheral vessel, femoral or axillary artery. because anticipated special technique as hip hypothermic circulatory arrest. Monitoring include right radial of femoral arterial line or bilateral arterial line if special perfusion technique is performed, usually PA catheter place and TE probe. Special technique for aortic arch procedure is deep hypothermic circulatory arrest with cerebral protection. Deep hypothermic circulatory arrest frequently used for standing aorta if there is anticipated reconstruction of hemi-arch. Common complication for standing aorta surgery is bleeding, coronary ischemia, particularly if ostia of coronaries were re-implanted, and major complication of aortic arch procedure, its transient and neurological dysfunction and permanent neurological injury, as well as bleeding. Talking about brain protection for aortic arch reconstruction, we talk about deep systemic hypothermia, topical cerebral cooling, retrograde cerebral perfusion, and selective antegrade cerebral perfusion. We need to mention pharmacological neuroprotection, even there is no sufficient data to use it. Was offered high dose of glucocorticoids, magnesium sulfate, lidocaine, mannitol. Inhaled anesthetic agents through ischemic preconditioner, an experimental study has promising results for brain protection. Another technique is prevention of cerebral hyperthermia during rewarming. Deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. It was introduced in 1970s to protect the brain from ischemic injury for operation on aortic arch with interruption of cerebral blood flow. Physiologic basis for neuroprotection is to decrease cerebral metabolic rate and oxygen demand and to increase period of time that the brain can tolerate circulatory arrest. Recent estimation of cerebral metabolism in adult undergoing deep hypothermic circulatory arrest suggests an ischemic tolerance of 30 minutes at 15 degrees of Celsius and 40 minutes and 10 degrees of Celsius. Physiologic measurements and clinical outcome study favor nasopharyngeal temperature in the range of 11 to 14 degrees of Celsius for deep hypothermic circulatory arrest and maximum safe duration of 30 minutes. Average nasopharyngeal temperature used for deep hypothermic circulatory arrest reported as 18 degrees Celsius, but optimal temperature has not been established yet. Disadvantage of deep hypothermic circulatory arrest included low brain temperature extends duration of bypass for cooling and rewarming. This may cause injury to blood elements and formation of aggregates of platelets and fat with possible cerebral embolization. Rewarming after reconstruction of aorta increases cerebral metabolic rate and makes the brain more vulnerable to ischemic injury during reperfusion. Special rewarming slow strategies should be used. Systemic hypothermia is associated with coagulopathy and increased risk of bleeding. Deep hypothermic circulatory arrest is a time-limited technique. For longer period of arrest, different form of perfusion needs to be implemented in order to avoid brain damage. Several techniques have been proposed. Retrograde cerebral perfusion, first described for the treatment of massive cerebral embolism, from 1990s used as technique to deliver metabolic substrate to the brain during operation involving aortic arch. Performed by infusion called oxygenated blood retrograde to the superior vena cava at temperature 8 to 14 degrees Celsius with flow rate 0.2-0.6 liter per minute. Internal jugular venous pressure is maintained at less than 25 millimeters of mercury to prevent cerebral edema. Potential benefit of neuroprotection with retrograde cerebral perfusion include extension of circulatory arrest time, flushing of embolic material from cerebral arteries vasculature to decrease risk of embolization, partial metabolic substrate delivery to the brain, maintaining cerebral hypothermia during arrest, and this technique is safe and easily implemented. Another technique performed is selective anterograde cerebral perfusion. During deep hypothermia on cardiopulmonary bypass, individual cannulas are inserted into coronary, innominate, and left common carotid arteries. Anterograde cerebral perfusion with oxygenated blood at 10 to 14 degrees Celsius and flow rate of 0.25 to 1 liter per minute typically achieves a cerebral perfusion pressure of 50 to 80 millimeter of mercury. Anterograde cerebral perfusion should be considered for all procedures with deep hypothermic circulatory arrest exceeding 45 minutes. Limitation of this technique include risk of cerebral embolization, vessel injury, non-uniform perfusion, and complexity of the procedure. Neuromonitoring during deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. EEG, electroencephalography. EEG changes during ischemia as loss of amplitude, loss of fast frequency, increased slow frequency activity occur when cerebral flow is about 20 millimeters per 100 grams per minute and isoelectric activity record at 12 millimeters per 100 grams per minute. Those changes represent decreased perfusion and hypotension on cardiopulmonary bypass. Transcranial Doppler of the middle cerebral artery. This technique can detect embolic events. Jugular bulb oxygenation saturation reflects the balance between oxygen supply and demand. It depends on cerebral blood flow and changes in the level of jugular bulb oxygenation may be valuable for recognition of hypotension and increased cerebral vascular resistance. For the last several years, big interest brought cerebral oximetry or near-infrared spectrophotometry. During brain hypoperfusion, it shows average decrease in cerebral oxygenation and can be monitored. Unlike standard pulse oximetry, pulsatile flow is not required for this technique, and therefore device can be used during all stage of cardiopulmonary bypass. BIS monitoring. His value decreased with hypothermia on a linear 1 to 100 scale and with temperature below 18 degrees of Celsius has been shown to decrease to zero. It seems to be reasonable correlation between recovery of BIS value and duration of deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. All those monitor can be used during procedures on arch. Anesthesia management points for surgery on ascending aorta and aortic arch aneurysm. General anesthesia and facilitation of conduction of cardiopulmonary bypass should be accomplished. Invasive pressure monitor usually include arterial line, PA catheter. TE, it's very important for aortic dissection surgery, especially for identification of flap extension. You should have sufficient AV access to manage bleeding and correct coagulopathy. Monitoring of depth of anesthesia and neurological monitoring, especially during time of deep hypothermic circulatory arrest, very important. Supportive brain protection measure as a topical cerebral cooling or ice on the head, pharmacological agent should be given if acceptable. Correction of hyperglycemia, anemia, acidosis, inotropic and vasoactive support after cardiopulmonary bypass. It's a major component for anesthesia management. Thoracoabdominal aneurysm. Crawford classification of thoracoabdominal aortic aneurysm depends on aneurysm expansion. Type 1 aneurysm expands from origin of subclavian artery and extends to the level of renal arteries. Type 2 expands the entire length of thoracoabdominal aorta from subclavian artery to the bifurcation of aorta and pelvis. Type 3 involves the middle of descending aorta and extends to bifurcation of the aorta and pelvis. Type 4 originates from the upper portion of abdominal aorta and extends to the bifurcation of the aorta and pelvis. There are several ways to accomplish surgical repair of distended thoracic or thoracoabdominal aortic aneurysm. First technique is a simple aortic cross clamp technique without bypass or distal perfusion. Its major disadvantage is concomitant vital organ ischemia below the aortic clamp. Surgical speed is critical to achieve, and ischemic time should be less than 30 minutes to limit risk for vital organ dysfunction. Further disadvantages include proximal aortic hypertension, bleeding, and hemodynamic instability on reperfusion. Despite anesthetic intervention, this proximal aortic hypertension may induce left ventricular ischemia. Hemodynamic instability during reperfusion can be minimized with correction of metabolic acidosis and rapid intravascular volume expansion. This is a big challenge, and big fall in blood pressure can be noted after cross clamp is off, and anesthesiology provider should be ready for this. Second technique, it's a passive shunting from proximal to distal aorta, or heparin-coated God shunt. Blood from the proximal to distal aorta through God shunt depends on proximal aortic pressure, shunt length and diameter, and distal aortic pressure. Monitoring the femoral artery pressure facilitates assessment of distal aortic perfusion and shunt flow. Disadvantage of shunt include vessel injury, dislodgement, bleeding, or embolism. Third technique is partial left heart bypass. Left atrium to left femoral artery to cannulas. Centrifugal pump usually used It can employ oxygenator and heat exchanger too. Minimal or no heparin when heparin-coated circuits used. Bypass flow is usually 1.5 to 2.5 liters per minute necessary to maintain distal aortic pressure of 60 to 70 millimeters of mercury. This technique widely used for thoracoabdominal aortic repair and for descending thoracic aortic aneurysm. And it needs very a lot of work done between anesthesiologist and perfusionist and surgeon to correlate distal and proximal pressure on aorta. Another technique is partial cardiopulmonary bypass, left femoral vein to femoral artery. It implicates full anticoagulation. Deep hypothermic circulatory arrest can be used with total cardiopulmonary bypass if extent of proximal part of aneurysm goes to the distal aortic arch. Management for descending and thoracoabdominal aneurysms. Surgical approach for those procedures is usually left lateral thoracotomy or thoracoabdominal incision. Perfusion performed by partial left heart bypass, cardiopulmonary bypass, including or not including deep hypothermic circulatory arrest. Monitor including proximal right arm arterial line and distal femoral line, PA catheter and TEE. Special technique is one lung ventilation, good venous access for volume and blood pressure management, motor or somatosensory evoke potential, selective spinal cord cooling, cerebrospinal fluid drainage, and renal preservation. Common complication of this procedure. Paraplegia is the main concern after repair of the descending or thoracoabdominal aorta. Renal mesenteric lower extremity ischemia can be present. Respiratory failure due to thoracoabdominal incision and division of the diaphragm. Risk factor for spinal cord ischemia during procedure on thoracoabdominal or descending aorta includes extent of aneurysm, occlusive peripheral vascular disease, hypertension or cardiogenic shock, aortic rupture or dissection, anemia, emergency operation, cross clamping of the aorta proximal to the blood supply of the spinal cord, duration of the cross clamp, risk increase if more than 30 minutes cross clamping, sacrifice of intercostal or segmental artery branches, single critical artery of Adamkiewicz, or more than 10 pairs of intersegmental arteries. Typically, injury affects anterior part of spinal cord. There is several strategies for spinal cord ischemia prevention. Distal aortic perfusion monitoring should be performed and mean arterial blood pressure should be maintained in more than 80 millimeters of mercury. Hypothermic circulatory arrest can be used. Selective spinal cord cooling with cold normal saline via epidural space. Strongly recommended to use lumbar cerebrospinal fluid drainage to lower risk of paraplegia. Intraoperative motor or somatosensory evoke potential can be useful for monitor potential ischemia. Arterial pressure augmentation should be done with vasopressors if needed. And pharmacological neuroprotection has been proposed. Naloxone, papaverine, steroids. Anesthesia management points. For procedures of thoracoabdominal distending aorta, general anesthesia or combined general and epidural anesthesia used. Second invasive blood pressure monitor should be used and blood pressure augmentation considered. Sufficient IV access to manage bleeding and profound falls in blood pressure, especially after unclamping of aorta. Management of one lung ventilation. Monitoring of depth of anesthesia and neurological monitoring. Management of cerebrospinal fluid drainage should be performed by anesthesiologist. Transesophageal echocardiography is very useful, especially to monitoring cardiac performance during procedure. Monitoring of coagulopathy and correction of coagulopathy is a very important issue. Thromboelastogram in series should be considered. Correction of hyperglycemia, anemia, and acidosis, especially after visceral reperfusion. And temperature regulation. If for procedure considered to be normal mild hypothermia, patient should be rewarmed after reperfusion accomplished. Now I want you to see TE clips of descending aorta dissection. On the first clip, you can see descending aortic dissection, false lumen with spontaneous echocontrast and true lumen of aorta. Second clip shows you true lumen, it's smaller with a flow in aorta, false lumen, you couldn't appreciate flow, and left-sided big pleural effusion. Thank you.